Okay, good evening, and thank you very much, my dear friend and colleague, Honorable Justina Charles, Parliamentary Representative for the Grande Constituency. Let me recognize the presence of our political leader and Prime Minister and Minister of Finance, Honorable Dr. Roosevelt Skerritt. Also, my dear friend, very close friend of mine, Honorable Johnson Drago. He said that we started this journey together with the Charles way back in 2009. I also recognize on the front row, two other members of the quintet of Cabinet Sisters, a group of five, Honorable Catherine Daniel and also Honorable Rosalind Paul. And my buddy at Cabinet, Honorable Peter Sejean from the neighboring La Plaine constituency. Let me also recognize the Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of Agriculture, Mr. Gies and his beautiful wife, and also members of the audience. I see quite a number of people from Pichelin here. Just to let you know that your meeting is also carried for Thursday, but the fact that you're here tonight means that two things. Number one, you're first for supporting this administration, and also that your support to the Member of Parliament for Granby and also your government. Also in a special way to welcome the Dubic residents who now form part of the geophysical space of the Granby constituency. Let me welcome you in a special way. And of course, your very own Granby people. Of course, I feel even as much a part of the Granby community as much as Petite Savanne, because I would have spent the better part of 14 years residing in Granby, and Ms. Charles, of course, would be my pal rep, and she will tell you that I put a lot of pressure on her, if I may be allowed to say so, for the Ballot Park Road, which is where I reside temporarily. And not only have I been a member of the Granby community for the past 14 years, I also found love, true love in Granby, and which is it. Yes. So I really want to thank the Member of Parliament, Honorable Justina Charles, for inviting me just to share a few thoughts with you tonight. And one of the pleasures, I said, one of the good things about speaking down the list of speakers is that a lot would have been said already that you planned on saying. But it doesn't mean that I wouldn't have a few thoughts of my own. First of all, to lend my solidarity to the Honorable Justina Charles. Of course, the historical friendship between Petite Savanne and Granby goes back decades. In fact, from what I recall, that except between the period of 1990 and 1995, when I think Petite Savanne would have voted the Dominica Freedom Party and Granby would have already voted the Labour Party, from as way back as 1995, Granby and Petite Savanne would have voted the Dominica Labour Party. And once upon a time, when the Labour Party, of course, was in the doldrums, maybe the five or six seats, that Granby and Petite Savanne formed part of that team that held the Dominica Labour Party together. So we have very strong historical ties, and of course the proximity. In fact, I always tease Ms. Charles when you talk about, remember the rehabilitation of the Granby to Lubia to Granby Road. I tell Ms. Charles it doesn't pass in the constituency at all. In fact, it passed within the Petite Savanne constituency, although she claimed it for one, but that's okay, you know, we are friends. So your Member of Parliament and myself, as I said, we go back a long way. Of course, we work together as part of the Granby Health Team. So I think it would be remiss of me if I don't come spend a few minutes, actually just to offer some words of solidarity. And on that note, I think it would also be remiss of me if I don't take us back to August of 2015, when Ms. Charles, myself, were one of the first responders to Petite Savanne. I remember the morning of August 27th, it was, 28th of 2015, when we took this short and very stressful helicopter ride to Petite Savanne. And Ms. Charles, without hesitation, formed part of that team heading to Petite Savanne. God knows what we were going to find there. And not only that, on a return to Granby, when I had to remain in Petite Savanne, of course, to make sure that everything was okay in Petite Savanne, Ms. Charles single-handedly took it on her own to ensure that, first of all, the residents of Dubic were properly taken care of, and also visited the Pichelin area to reassure them that everything is okay, and to, of course, maintain the government presence in that time. So I really want to thank you, Ms., like I've done many, many times before. I think that went a long way into allaying the fears of the people in that post tropical South America period. And you've been a pillar of support to me. In fact, I told her sometimes, especially when things get a little rough in the politics, that she herself would have played an integral role in encouraging me to enter politics. And when things get rough, of course, I blame her. But Yeah. but honestly, and even a bit later down, when we were looking for lands to settle the Dibi community, Nishals willingly volunteered the land at center, top quality, real prime real estate of Grand Bay, to resettle the Dibi community. And I really want to thank, as I said, for her willingness to give up some of her prime real estate right in the back here to settle the Dibi residents, and which we did in record time, just 1 year after Erica settled 50 Dibi and families. And while as a member of parliament, I know that you would have your little ongoing issues. Okay, but you must say that your government would have responded to you in a timely and efficient manner post-Erica. Because by any stretch of the imagination, building 50 homes within a one-year period towards 50 families, I think is a tremendous feat. So I think you really need to. Because a lot of times we take certain things for granted, people. We take certain things for granted, okay? But when we look back, when you look back as to where we were August 27th of 2015, and even just after that, we have indeed come a long way. So I'm really hoping that the Dibi community, that first of all, apart from, of course, lending your support to the government by extension, we need to be forever thankful to the Member of Parliament for Grand Bay for welcoming us into a geophysical space. In addition, I would also like to take a few minutes, of course, to update you because the purpose of some of these town hall meetings, as I said, is to share information with you. And oftentimes we hear a lot of things on the radio, different radio stations, a lot of the, especially the younger population, social media, especially Facebook. We see lots of things and lots of rumors, lots of propaganda being spread. As it pertains, first of all, to the new National Hospital and a couple of the other hot topics. The new National Hospital has started, as you well know. We are currently in phase one of the project. And of course, I know the eternal question that a lot of people would be asking from time to time is, why didn't you guys go to a new site to avoid all of these concerns and all of these issues we think that would surface with building on an active hospital site? And of course, as I said, while that maybe would have been our thinking, we were advised by the experts on a number of occasions, from PAHO, from WHO, and even our very own medical people, that given the spread and demographics of the population, that it would be easier to build on the current hospital site. So while a lot of people said it was never going to happen, a lot of people said it was a political gimmick, it wasn't going to happen, it has finally started, and we're well on the way into a state-of-the-art new national hospital. And I can assure you as the Minister of Health that so far progress on the hospital is going along smoothly, and your government would have taken a number of steps to ensure that the construction of the hospital progresses smoothly. Of course, like everything else, we will have little hitches. You build a little shack, you build a seven-bedroom mansion, you will have little problems along the way. But we have put things in place to ensure that as soon as these problems arise, that we need them right in the board. So we expecting phase one to be completed by the August of this year. So by the August of this year, you're expected to have your brand new accident and emergency department together with two operating theaters and also a second medical building completed housing your MRI, your new MRI equipment, x-rays, scans, etc. So come August of this year, we should be commissioning the first phase of this hospital. And we need to be reminded from time to time as to the funding of this hospital, $40 million. The last time I calculated it, this was 108 million EC dollars. And this is a gift, every cent, every penny of this, a gift from our friends of the People's Republic of China. And this is noteworthy, because some of us, especially those of us who follow politics closely, would recall that when the Honorable Prime Minister decided to forge diplomatic relations with mainland China or the People's Republic of China, he came under serious criticism, China being a communist country. And the opposition, of course, at this time tried to instill fear in the average Dominicans that we were selling out to communist China, and pretty soon our young boys and young girls would be sent to China to join the army. All sorts of ridiculous propaganda. But today we are seeing the results. Today we are seeing the results of these foreign policies established by our brave young prime minister. And I must say, and I think I shared that thought with my friend this Charles when I was asked to join politics that medicine has always been my love. I mean, I've never wanted to be anything else but a doctor since I could probably say my name. But I think the only thing that could have enticed me to leave my first love to enter politics would have been because of the example set by the Prime Minister. And I'll tell you why. Because I felt that as a young Prime Minister, he made some brave and bold steps for the better of the country. He was willing to move, to think outside the box, move past our traditional friends, and willing to explore uncharted territory. And today we see the results of all of this unfolding before us. And we can speak for the rest of the night as to our friends in China in terms of educational opportunities, not to mention the massive infrastructural projects that they would have funded. The stadium, which can allow us right now to see test match crickets, whereas before we'd be limited to watching it on TV. And I remember in my days growing up as a little boy listening on shortwave radio. Of course, we graduated into cable TV, et cetera. The Dominica State College, a number of the new Newton Primary School, and I can spend the rest of the night speaking as to the number of projects that our friends from China would have funded. So your new state-of-the-art hospital is here, it has started, and we see, and given the track record of our Chinese friends, our Chinese counterparts, and they told us that they're going to complete the hospital in 30 months, 2.5 years, and given the track record of our Chinese friends, rest assured, but by 2018, you are going to have a complete new state-of-the-art hospital, complete with new equipment, complete with trained doctors and new services. Because as I said, that a new hospital on its own wouldn't cut it. We also have to ensure that we have the trained doctors. And as we speak, a number of our young people are being trained overseas in various specialties, new and exciting services such as intensive care, emergency medicine, geriatrics, which is to do with our senior citizens, a number of specialties. So apart from the new building, you're also going to have a number of new and exciting new services available here on the island. So there will be very little need to now travel overseas. We're not saying that we'll completely eliminate the need, but there will be very little need to now travel overseas because you're going to have the equipment and the personnel at the hospital to be able to deal with a number of the ailments right here in Dominica. So, but we also tell ourselves, and we know that medical care is very, very expensive, and it's no secret. I mean, we go to the private doctors sometimes, we pray just to see them. Then we have to pay another money to do the test they send us to do. Then sometimes just to drop the test to the secretary, we have to pay another money. And also then for the doctors to interpret the results for us, we have to pay another money, okay? So there is no denying the tremendous cost, okay, or expense incurred in medical. And I need to say that especially as the Minister of Health, for those of us who access the primary healthcare services at the health facilities where most, if not all, of the treatment and medication, okay, we get it for free. We have to understand that while it is free to you, it comes at a cost to the state. And I can tell as the Minister of Health, every year we get requests from the health people to increase our budget for the procurement of medicines. $9 million is spent each year just to buy these pills that you get at the health center for free. So we have to understand while it is free to you, it comes at a cost to the government of Dominica. So you ask yourself now, with the new hospital and the new equipment, all the new services, but people, each and everybody has to be able to access these services. And I tell you why, okay? It cannot be that we have a new hospital with new equipment and new services and only rich people like, I can use Drago because it's my partner, rich people like Drago, okay, will access this hospital. These services have to be for each and everyone, from Minister Brown to the poor rural farmer I can call in Petite Savanne. This each and every service has to be accessible to everybody. So which is why over the years, governments have been grappling with what we call universal health coverage. Because given the cost of rising medical care, we understand, we now have to devise ways where our people can access these costly medical interventions. So you've been hearing talk about the national health insurance for a number of years. Even governments before us would be engaging in discussions as to a national health insurance. But it had to take this Labour Party administration, your government under the leadership of the Honourable Rudolph Skerrit as Minister of Finance, to commit $5 million in this financial year towards a pilot, what they call National Health Insurance Program. Okay, I think this is commendable, people, okay? A pilot National Health Insurance Program. And of course, the thinking is that we are starting with single mothers, 35 years and below, I think with children, 3 years and below, if I recall. But the thinking is that as we go along, we will start adding more target groups until eventually each and every citizen, especially those who do not have the luxury or those who can afford the conventional health insurance, until all of these people are covered. So I really want to commend you, Mr. Prime Minister, and it's been, of course, implemented by the Ministry of Finance. But like I've done many times, the Ministry of Health stands ready, sir, to allow you the smooth implementation of this National Health Insurance Program. Just to wind down, because I want to give the audience, and I see you in full force tonight, so I'm pretty sure we're going to have a lot of questions from the audience. Just to go quickly, also the new Marigot Hospital, just to empower you with knowledge. This would also have been a hot topic, and of course you would have heard the Member of Parliament for Marigot ranting and raving and raging and foaming at the mouth. I was about to use chime, you know, okay, it sounds a little, but foaming at the mouth as to how Marigot have been marginalized as it pertains to the healthcare. But just to let you know that we have $1.5 million budgeted in this financial year towards the designs and start the works of rebuilding the Marigot Health Center and the Marigot Hospital. We would have had our challenges in getting this project off the way. I explained at a number of town hall meetings, of course, the technical advice. We have in just one small department, the Public Works Ministry, to advise us. But your cabinet and government would have given the Ministry of Health the luxury in appointing or employing our very own project officer and supporting staff, so we can now manage our projects, so we don't have to depend on the Public Works Ministry, so we can move smoothly with these projects. A number of other projects carried in this financial year, the Vehicles Health Center, Collie Ho, I see my good friend, I'm Lady Danielle, and also considering a new facility for Newton. So all of these are things that we have carried down for implementation under the Ministry of Health. But before I leave, I think it would also be remiss of me if I don't also lend my voice, although the Honorable Charles, I'm your pal rep, and I'm sure the Prime Minister will expound on it, the issue of the CBI. Because, I mean, say what you want about Ms. Charles, you may like her, you may not like her, but you have a hard-working pal rep, an extremely hard-working pal rep. And she will tell you the number of times, and of course a couple of us alluded to it. Every time the Minister of Finance makes money available to us, okay, she will always. And one thing about this child, she's not like me, as this is scribbling little things on paper. If you realize, she can have all the stuff printed in tables and everything well organized. So before the Prime Minister say, okay, folks, we have some money to, okay, yeah, Mr. PM, okay, and I think she herself alluded to it, or Honorable Drago, when the Prime Minister asked us for a comprehensive list of roads within our constituency that needed rehabilitating. I mean, the Shells, everybody else, I produced a list of upcoming to about $1.7 million. She produced a list of almost $7 million. And I'm like, okay, let's just take everything for yourself. but seriously, you have a very hard-working pal rep. And the little that she gave you of our report card speaks volumes, because let's be honest, people, a lot of the things that Ms. Charles would have done in her one term and a couple of years are stuff that would have been on the pipelines for a very long time to do, and she finally got to do it. So let's be a bit patient. Yes, there will always be things to be done, but let us forget what was done that had to be done long time ago that she finally did. Okay, so Ms. Charles, I'm telling you, from where we sit in cabinet, I think the cabinet of Dominica have tremendous respect for your Honorable Member of Parliament, Justina Charles. Very organized and delivering to her people. So all of these wonderful things that she would have done, and she said she's going to do, you have to ask yourself, but hold on a while, Tropical Storm Erica happened Tropical Storm Erica happened almost 2 years ago and left us a debt of $1.4 billion. And every time I speak to that, I said $1.4 billion, say per million. Million ni 60, billion ni nef, okay? So $1.4 billion. Now you ask yourself, that means that as we speak, your government should only be concentrating on repairing, repairing, fixing back, replacing the bridges, the whatever infrastructure that was left. So where is your government getting money to do all of these exciting new projects? Okay? Where is your government getting the, where are we going to get the money? These proceeds come from the Citizenship by Investment program. And don't be fooled, people. All of this nonsense here, the opposition ranting and raving about the CBI, because they understand the importance of the CBI right now. And they know that in 3 years' time, when election is called up before, I'm not in the prime minister head, that by the time we run all of these programs that the CBI funding is being used to do, the washrooms, and the prime minister would have said publicly that by the end of 2017, he wants all washrooms, all pit latrines around Dominica eliminated, and also the complete rehabilitation of all community roads. They know that once all of these things are rolled out, they don't stand a chance at the next election, which is why they tried their best to try to come in back door. They've tried all kind of stuff. But rest assured that whatever happened on the night of February 7th, don't be fooled, it was of their doing. So why they tried to make us believe that it was random acts by some little Vianeg in Roseau, it was planned. And I'll tell you why. Our CBI program has been very successful for a number of reasons. And even if a number of other Caribbean islands were engaged in the CBI on a larger scale before us, we have managed to surpass them. And I'll tell you why. For a number of reasons. Dominica has been labeled as a political and very socially politically stable country, meaning that you, the Dominican people, you know what you want. You voted the same government for the past four terms, for the past four elections. Very stable. Our crime rate is low, and then we are ripe for investment. So all of these attempts at destabilizing the country and unrest, because let's face it, the pictures that appeared on social media on the night of February 7th did not look good, people. For a minute, we thought that you were in Baghdad or one of these countries. So when investors see these pictures, these images about Dominica, they will then think twice about investing. But thank God there's a God above, and all the efforts at derailing the CBI program are being thwarted. And I want to thank the Cabinet of Dominica for standing solidly behind the Prime Minister and, of course, the rest. Because never before have we been so united as a cabinet, and I wanted to share that with Dominican people. And when you look sometimes, or you listen, you follow regional politics, and sometimes you hear of the internal squabbling among cabinets, even among sister countries, there has never been better unity or more unity in the cabinet of Dominica than now. Because we recognize that we're up against an enemy who is prepared to do whatever they have to do to get into government. But tell them it's not going to happen that way. Because Petite Savanne, Grand Bay, and a number of other constituencies are going to vote back the Labour Party whenever the Prime Minister calls elections. So, in closing, people, one thing I want to leave with you, especially to my people from Petite Savanne, I'm not sure if we have a few of them in the audience, because I know we have a number of them resident here in Grand Bay. And to those who, of course, tend to lean or to support all of this nonsense that the DWP is ruling, you also need to understand, and I will say it every time I get an opportunity to speak, that the success of the Petite Savanne resettlement, a project which is going to cost more than $100 million, the success, the continuation and the completion of this project is going to depend solely on the continuation of the CBI program. So while we can speak of a number of other exciting projects like the Kepinski Hotel and Jungle Bay, etc., being funded under the CBI, closer to home, closer to my heart, is the resettlement of the Petite Savanne people. So when they think they join in forces, the operation to try to bring down the government, they need to understand that if our CBI program fails, people, I will say it in local parlance so that everybody can understand, Kaipul Kwaze, and all of the wonderful, all of the assistance that they're getting from the government, the rent being paid and the displacement allowance, all of this thing is going to stop. And the government will have no choice but to tell you, listen, we have held your hands as long as we could. Our current revenue to assist you has been destroyed. So you now go there and dig with your cow, okay? So we need to understand what's at stake for the Petite Savanne people and for the rest of the country. All of these other wonderful programs like the Feeder Roads and the Washroom Program, all of this depends on the CBI program. So I really want to, on behalf of the Petite Savanne constituency, to thank you, and also on behalf of the Labour Party administration, to thank the Grand Bay people for holding strong with the Dominican Labour Party throughout all these years. And I think it would be remiss of me if I don't mention also the resettlement of Dubuque, the ongoing project within Dubuque of $2.6 million that will do the walls and the roads within Dubuque to make the place look nicer. All of these proceeds come from the CBI. Okay, so we need to understand, as I said, what's at stake, especially when we tend to be sensitive or even listening to the crap being thrown out there by the opposition. We need to understand that a lot of these things will stop. So in closing, as I said, I really want to thank your people for the Petite Savanne and Granby constituencies for holding strong Labour Party. And I have no doubt, in spite of the occasional rumblings here and there, your little dissent, your power, hey, I have a lot of people that may be in the constituency who will have little dissent from time to time. But I know when the clarion call is, when the clarion is sounded, when the trumpet is sounded by the Honourable Prime Minister, we will all close ranks together and vote back the best government that Dominica has ever seen, the Dominican Labour Party. Thank you very much.